Hello, in this video I'd like to talk about how we can calculate the gravity inside of a hollow sphere without doing any antidifferentiation. Whenever you're doing these sorts of applied multivariable calculus problems involving gravity, or more likely electromagnetism, electromagnetic force working very similar to how gravitational force works, you're very likely to be in one of two situations. Either there's some clever way of solving the problem that works out very nicely, you don't have to do any integrals at all. Or if you try to do the integrals, it winds up being the case that there's no nice formula for the antiderivative that you're trying to calculate. In which case, you're going to have to resort to numerical methods in order to get any sort of concrete answers. So here I've drawn kind of a cross-section of a spherical shell. So it's hollow on the inside, and it has some mass on the outside. And I'm interested, if we have some sort of point within this spherical shell, what sort of force of gravity are we going to experience? Right? If we're located here and we have some mass, we're going to be pulled towards all of the matter making up this hollow spherical shell. And the question is, when we add up all of those gravitational forces, what total force are we going to experience? To make things simple, let's suppose that the point that we're interested in is directly above the center of the sphere. By symmetry, the amount that this left side of the sphere pulls to the left and this right side of the sphere pulls to the right are going to balance each other out. So there isn't going to be any gravitational force, any net gravitational force in the left or right directions. And similarly, there isn't going to be any net gravitational force into or out of the board. The force of gravity is going to be exclusively either upwards or downwards. Also by symmetry, we can expect that the force of gravity that we experience over here, well, it's going to be either left or right, but it's going to be the same amount of force and in the same direction, either inwards or outwards, as we experience over here. And if we draw an imaginary sphere of radius, let's call this radius here, capital R, around the origin, around the center of the hollow sphere, then we expect all of the points on this sphere to experience the same magnitude of gravitational force by symmetry. It would be really weird if points over here experienced more or less gravitational force than points over here, because we can just rotate the sphere to move points over here to points over here without changing the system at all. So we expect the gravitational force to be, well, we don't expect the direction to be the same, but we expect the magnitude to be the same, and whether it's inward or outward to be the same. So I'm going to draw a bunch of arrows around this imaginary inner sphere with their gravitational forces. I'm going to guess that the gravitational force is pointing outwards, but I have no reason for that guess. I'll just guess that direction, and if when we do the math we get a negative number, then that means that the force was actually inwards. But the key thing here is that we know that all of these force arrows are going to be the same length, and they're all going to be pointing outwards. Everything here is radially symmetric. Now, here's the clever bit that's going to allow us to calculate the magnitude of this gravitational force. We're going to consider the flux integral of this gravitational field through the surface of this imaginary sphere. So what does this flux integral mean? We're adding up over the surface the gravitational field at each point dot producted with the area vector for a tiny piece of the surface. These sorts of imaginary surfaces that we calculate the flux through in order to do some sort of clever trick to easily get the solution to some sort of gravitational or electromagnetic problem are called Gaussian surfaces. And the key thing is that there's two ways of calculating this flux integral. The first is to rewrite it as a surface integral. We can use our dot product rule to break this up as the length of f times the cosine of the angle between our gravitational field and the direction of these tiny little surface vectors times the area of these tiny little surface pieces. This angle here is always going to be zero. The direction of the tiny little surface pieces, remember that we represent surfaces by vectors that are perpendicular to them. So a tiny little surface piece here is going to be represented by a vector that's pointing in the same direction as the gravitational field. So this cosine of the angle here is just going to be one. And then we also said that the magnitude of the gravitational force at all of the different points over the surface, over our Gaussian surface, they're all going to be equal. And that's really kind of one of the key things about Gaussian surfaces. It works out very nicely if the gravitational force or whatever sort of field you're looking at is constant over that surface. So we can actually just pull that constant out of the integral. And this constant, this is the thing that we're trying to solve for. We're interested in the magnitude of the gravitational force that we get here. But notice what we have here. What we're left with here is a surface integral that's just calculating the area of the surface, right? If you have an integral with nothing in it, it's just calculating the area or the volume or whatever of the region that you're integrating over. In this case, it's a surface, so we're calculating its area, and we know what that area is, right? We know what the area of the surface of a sphere is. It's just 4 pi r squared. So this is one way of calculating this integral, and there's another way of calculating this integral, and by calculating this integral another way, we'll be able to work out what the magnitude of f is. Specifically, we're going to calculate this integral using the divergence theorem. We can calculate the flux flowing out of the region by simply adding up over the interior of the region of how much the field is spreading out, the divergence of the field, and integrating that over the entire volume. Now, it might look like we've actually gotten ourselves into a lot more work. In order to do this, we would have to calculate the gravitational field from this ring at every point in order to be able to get the divergence, because we would need some sort of formula to take the divergence of. But here's the clever thing. When we're looking at a gravitational field, its divergence at any point is going to just be a reflection of the mass density. Let me show you what I mean. Let's calculate the divergence of the gravitational field of just a single point. So let's suppose that we have a single point located at the origin with mass little m and some sort of point located at the point xyz with mass big M, and we're interested in the gravitational force that this particular point feels as a function of x, y, and z. This force is going to be some sort of vector, right? We have a direction to this force, and it's going to depend on x, y, and z, and it's specifically going to be the gravitational constant times the mass of one of the particles times the mass of the other particle over the distance between the two squared. The distance between these two points is just the square root of x squared plus y squared plus z squared, and we have to square that, which will actually get rid of the square root. But this is just the magnitude of the force. This isn't the vector for the force. We need a vector of this length pointing in this direction. And specifically, that's going to be, we can get that by multiplying by the vector x, y, z and dividing it by the length of the vector x, y, z. And there needs to be a minus sign here to indicate that the vector is pointing inwards towards the origin, but I like to toss that minus sign into the G because it saves me from having to write a bunch of minus signs and possibly losing one of those minus signs and getting really confused. So this vector here we can write out as the x component is going to be gmmx times x squared plus y squared plus z squared to the minus 3/2. Y component is going to be that with the x replaced by a y, and the z component we replace it with a z. So very nice and symmetric formula, which is going to make it easier to calculate the divergence of this thing. Remember that we're interested in the divergence of this gravitational field. And in particular, when we're calculating the divergence of something, we write divergence like this. The way I like to remember this is a nice mnemonic, although it's hard to say exactly how formal this is. I like to think of this NABLA symbol as representing the quote-unquote vector partial partial x, partial partial y, partial partial z. And so when we dot product this vector, heavy quotes here, with this vector here, we're just going to take the quote-unquote product of these two plus the product of these two plus the product of these two. So I'm taking the partial derivative of the first part plus with respect to x plus the partial derivative of the second part with respect to y plus the partial derivative of the third part with respect to z. Again, everything's going to be nicely symmetric. So this bit here, when we take the partial derivatives, this bit here is just a constant, so it's just a product rule. So I'm going to take the derivative of the first times the second, this is the easy one, plus the first times the derivative of the second. And this here is a chain rule, right? We take the exponent, we bring it down out front, but then we have to multiply by the derivative of the inside. When we're taking partial derivatives, we treat y and z as constants, so it's just x squared plus some constant. Take the derivative of that, it's just 2x. And of course, there's going to be a gmm for both of these terms here. And we're going to get similar terms when we take the partial derivative of this with respect to y and the partial derivative of this with respect to z. When we add up these three terms, we can cancel out these twos, and then we get this x squared plus y squared plus z squared to the minus 5/2 times, when we add these coefficients together, x squared plus y squared plus z squared. So that's actually going to put this whole thing back to a negative 3 times x squared plus y squared plus z squared to the minus 3/2. And then from these summands, we're also going to get a positive 3 x squared plus y squared plus z squared to the minus 3/2. So overall, this sum here is equal to 0. And the only reason why that worked is because we're in three dimensions, right? We needed three terms over here to cancel out the threes that we were getting over here. Now, there's actually a catch here. The divergence of the gravitational field of a point isn't zero everywhere. In particular, it's not zero at the point itself. It's infinity at this point. There is, if we visualize our gravitational field, some amount of negative divergence going on around this point. It's just that all of that negative divergence, all of that convergence, is happening at that point itself, not around the point at all. This is similar to, if you're familiar with the delta quote-unquote function, this is similar to that. So we have a singularity when we're trying to calculate the divergence of the gravitational field of a point. We have potential singularities where we see mass, but luckily in this original problem that we were interested in, we were interested in calculating the divergence of our gravitational field over the interior of this Gaussian surface here. And fortunately, there's no mass in there. So we don't need to worry about that singularity in the divergence. We can simply reason that all of these points on the surface of the sphere, they're all going to contribute to the gravitational field on the inside of our Gaussian surface in such a way that the gravitational field of all of these points has zero divergence on the inside of the sphere. And so when we add together all of those gravitational fields to get the gravitational field of the whole hollow sphere, the resulting divergence on the inside of our Gaussian surface is also going to be zero. And so that means that this divergence integral here is adding up a bunch of zeros. This integral is zero. And so that tells us that the magnitude of f times 4 pi r squared is equal to zero. And the only way that happens, well, unless r is equal to zero, but that's fine, there's no gravity at the center either. The only way for that to happen is if the magnitude of f is equal to zero. So there's no gravity at this point here or at any of these points here within a hollow sphere. So thanks for watching. Let me know if you have any questions or comments below, and be kind to each other.